funding for Indian Pride is provided by the Seminole Tribe of Florida, the Forest County Potawatomi Tribe, National City, the Otto Bremer Foundation, and the members of Prairie Public.
On this episode of Indian Pride, we look at the history and impact of Indian gaming, see how the cottonwood tree helps Little Star's wishes come true, and witness an amazing San Carlos Apache flamenco guitar picker. Hi. I'm Junie K. Randall, and welcome to Indian Pride. With the introduction of Indian gaming on and around Indian reservations, the economic opportunities and conditions are changing for some of the tribes. Others are moving at a slower pace and need more help to get their arms around their economic engines for the 21st century. Indian Pride examines and discusses the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act of 1988. That set the stage for economic impact for Indian nations and outlined the future for some of the more successful tribes in Indian country.
There are very few successes in Indian country in economic development. One clearly has been gaming under the 1988 Indian Gaming Regulatory Act. If anybody would have told me, for instance, just 20 years ago, that the gaming industry would now be hiring 558,000 people and making more money in Indian gaming than Las Vegas and Reno and Atlantic City make collectively, I never would have believed it. Only about half of all of the tribes in the United States have any gaming at all. There's a big misconception about that. Of all the tribes that do gain, I would venture to say probably 10% are making what we would call serious money. I mean big, big bucks. And in fact, there are some Indian gaming efforts that are really floundering and may not survive at all. So it doesn't work for every tribe.
Seminole Tribe is considered the grandfather of Indian gaming. When gaming first was introduced to Seminole, that's when we first ventured into the courts. The whole issue was whether or not Seminole could regulate. We proved that we could, and the courts upheld that, and so that started gaming on our reservation. There were about four tribes that worked very hard to create the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act. And out of that was the creation of NIGA, which is the Indian Gaming Association, one of the largest associations in Indian country today, and very influential in preserving gaming interest in Indian country.
There's a whole host of people that have jobs because of Indian gaming. Our tribe was one of two tribes in the United States to be able to obtain off-reservation gaming. The Indian Gaming Regulatory Act doesn't have a format of how they're going to screen applications for off-reservation at this point. We developed a policy in which we asked the Bureau of Indian Affairs to consider, and one of them was that it was, the traditional homeland, and number two, that it wouldn't adversely affect a neighboring tribe, and thirdly, that it didn't look and act like an Indian casino. I wish I could say that everything started out like a house of fire, but it really didn't. We was the only tribe in the state of Wisconsin that was limited to a number of machines that we could operate in our facility. But we had an unlimited amount of space for Class II gaming, which was bingo. I don't believe a legislative fix for Indian gaming would be good for anybody, because if it comes to that point, the legislator may say, you know what, we tried. And it's creating such a mess. Let's take the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act and do away with it.
I'm not supportive of off-reservation gaming. The gaming by Indian tribes is as a result of the Cabazon decision in front of the Supreme Court. They have a right to provide gaming, and it has provided an income stream for a good number of tribes that allows them to address some of the social needs of their tribe, and I support that, and I think that's fine. But there are many tribes that are trying to find ways now to do gaming off-reservation. I understand reservations are in many cases, a ways away from population centers. I just don't support this notion of moving wholesale to off-reservation gaming. I don't think it's the right thing to do.
The huge expansion of American Indian casinos throughout the United States has created a number of interesting issues for individual states to consider. Our guest today is Mr. Phil Hogen, Chairman of the National Indian Gaming Commission. Mr. Hogen was appointed by President Bush. He is an enrolled member of the Oglala Sioux Tribe of the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation in South Dakota. Today, we will be discussing Indian gaming. Welcome, Mr. Hogen, to Indian Pride.
Thank you. Very nice to be here.
Let's get started and have you give us a brief overview how Indian gaming got started here in America.
Okay, well, the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act was passed in 1988, and some think that started Indian gaming. Actually, Indians invented Indian gaming, and the government then came along and set up this structure. But in the late 70s, early 1980s, tribes were really desperate for resources to fund programs that they were unfunded and to meet unmet needs. And so some tribes, starting in places like Florida, Wisconsin, New York, they tried bingo. And it worked really well. And the better people liked it, the bigger the prizes got and so forth. And eventually, states challenged what tribes were doing, saying, you're violating our law. And so those cases eventually went to court. And for example, in Florida, the law said something like you can play bingo on Saturday night in church basements and you can only give away prizes of $100. Well, the Seminoles were playing all day, every day, and they were giving away hundreds of thousands of dollars of prizes. And the courts eventually said, well, Florida, you regulate your bingo. The tribes can regulate their bingo. As long as Florida didn't criminally prohibit it, then the tribes could go ahead and do it. And so then eventually a case went to the United States Supreme Court, Cabazon case from California, and the Supreme Court stayed by that rule, said, tribes, you may go ahead and do gambling as long as the state where you're doing it permits somebody to do that. And there are going to be some other rules that you'll have to follow. The Indian Gaming Regulatory Act, then adopted in 1988, set up this framework that we're following today.
So basically, if the states of the 50 states, if they had gambling in their state, so it was a natural fit for Indian gaming. But if the states did not have that law in place for the state, then they could not start gaming at all?
That's correct. For example, in Utah, no gambling, no bingo, nothing like that is permitted. And consequently, the tribes in Utah can engage in gaming. In my state, South Dakota, they legalized slot machines, blackjack, and poker only for the historic gold mining town of Deadwood. But they let somebody do it someplace in the state, so the tribes, therefore, are able to negotiate with the state under the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act for compacts to do that, what we call Class 3 gaming, on their reservations.
You mentioned Class 3 gaming. Explain to us the difference between Class 1, Class 2, and Class 3.
Okay, the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act divided gambling up. Class 1 gaming was traditional ceremonial games and gambling that tribes have been doing for hundreds of years.
Right.
And that's solely within the jurisdiction of the tribes. The tribe can do that kind of activity without any state or federal oversight. Class 2 gaming is bingo and games like bingo, pull tabs, non-bank card games. A bank card game is where you play against the house, like blackjack. If
right.
the player loses, the house wins. But if you're just playing against the other players around the table, that's non-banked. So that category of games tribes can do as long as the state says it's not illegal for anybody to do that in the state. That's kind of the bedrock on which Indian gaming was built. Then Class 3 gaming is the gaming that's everything else. Slot machines, bank card games, parimutuel racing, the other kind of casino games like roulette and craps and so forth. And for tribes to do that, they have to enter into a compact with those states that permit some form of that gaming, and then the gaming will be conducted pursuant to that compact. Now the compact, once negotiated by the tribe and the state, has to go to the Secretary of the Interior, who has to review it and approve it before it's valid.
Your office, the Office of the Commission, is under the Interior Department, correct?
We're an independent regulatory agency within the Department of the Interior. Not everybody always agrees what that means, but we are independent for the most part, but we are within the general structure.
Briefly tell me about the commission. How do you get appointed, and how many people are on the commission, and what is your job as commissions?
Okay, we're a three-member commission. I'm the chairman, and I'm appointed by the President of the United States. The two associate members of the commission are appointed by the Secretary of the Interior. And we serve for three-year terms or until our successor is appointed. The law says that at least two of those members have to be members of an Indian tribe. Currently, I'm Oglala Sioux, and Chuck Choney is a retired FBI agent, spent 26 years with the FBI.
Right.
He's a full blood. He's half Kiowa and half Comanche. He's enrolled in the Comanche tribe. And so those are the criteria for being members.
So when you go around Indian country and you are checking on the casinos, what is your job as commissions, and how do you enforce the laws?
Okay. We adopt some standards, adopt some regulations that tribes have to comply with if they're going to conduct gaming. They also have to annually do an audit of their gaming activities and send that audit to us, to the NIGC. We have a staff of about 100 people located in five different regional offices around the country. And we have investigators and we have auditors. They will make site visits to the casinos, to the bingo halls, to see that they are complying with the regulations and the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act. We also have to approve the tribe's own law, the tribal gaming ordinance. And we make sure that the gaming is conducted in compliance with that. If we find that something's not in compliance, we say to the tribes, let's fix it. And it's only kind of as a last resort that we would take enforcement action, which could include closing the tribal facility or assessing a fine. We don't like to do that, but in some cases we've had to.
So I know that there's millions of dollars to be made in Indian gaming. In 1988, it was millions, and now in 2006, it's billions. What do you see the future for Indian gaming as it relates to economic development for the Indian reservations that are directly impacted by the fact that they can have gaming?
Well, it certainly is a growing industry today. In 1995, it was about $6 billion of gross gaming revenue. Last year, it was nearly $23 billion, and it looks like it's going to continue to grow. Historically, the United States has gone through cycles when gaming was favored and when it was not favored. So I expect sometime in the future, probably, the pendulum will swing the other way. And during this time, the tribes need to make hay while the sun shines, so to speak, and put those dollars to good use, develop some other economic development projects with those proceeds.
Now, finally, I was going to ask you, what do you see in terms of the tribes that don't have gaming? What kind of future do they have? If they're not able to have gaming, do you see anything coming about in terms of being able to include them in some fashion?
Well, they certainly need to be creative. Indian gaming has been an economic miracle for those tribes that are located in the right places. Unfortunately, it is very much market-driven. If you're not located near a good market, a metropolitan area, the chances of finding gaming as a means of success aren't very good. So I think the tribes that aren't located near those markets are going to have to look through some other avenues. But one place they can look is those tribes that have, you know, made a lot of money that now are able to invest and assist their fellow tribes.
Phil, I want to thank you so much for joining us here today on Indian Pride. I'm in the area of Indian gaming. I'm sure there's a lot of unanswered questions, and hopefully we can have you back again and you can share some more wisdom with us about the future of Indian gaming and the economic impact for Indian country.
Thank you.
Grandchildren, I'm going to tell you another story. There, Machbiagikta, Wichachbiwa, Hechia. Up in the sky was this star. It was a little star, and it always went all over the sky, all across the universe. Omani unga tukte diye chanda shtakuku wayakara tayabadeza. wherever it went, it examined it very closely and tried to understand what it was. So it was traveling around the universe. All of a sudden, it saw this other star. It was bright and it was shining, so it went there. Here it was, this Earth. It went all around the Earth, stopped, looked at everything, looked at all the people who were living here, all the animals and everything, and all of a sudden it came to this village. It couldn't believe it. It heard the most beautiful sounds it ever heard. In all its travel across the universe, all around this Earth, it never heard anything so wonderful. It stayed there and it listened and listened and listened, just couldn't get enough of hearing that beautiful, those beautiful sounds that came from that village. And all of a sudden it thought, I'm a star. Looked back up into the sky and thought, that's where I'm supposed to be. So it went back up into the sky. And it got up there, the other stars said to it, where have you been? You're supposed to be up here with us. So this little star told the other stars where it was. I was down there to that place, he pointed to the Earth. And I just couldn't leave because I heard the most beautiful sounds. So then time went on, but the little star kept remembering the beautiful sounds it heard. And all of a sudden, then it just couldn't stand it anymore. It had to come back. So it went to the other stars and said, I'd like to go back down there because I miss that sound so much and I want to be there all the time. The other star said, no, you're a star. You belong up here in the sky. So it tried to live up there, but it couldn't. It just got so lonesome. Was just feeling just bad. Asked the stars again if it could go back down there so it could listen to the sounds. The star said, no, because you'll be hanging around that place where those people live. You'll be shining around and you'll keep them from their work. They have to take care of themselves, so they have to work, and you'll disrupt them. So the little star thought, if I can find a way to be close to that place without disturbing those people, can I stay there? They said, yes. Oh, we became so happy. Came back down to Earth and went back to that village. Looked around, and all those beautiful sounds were coming. And close to this village was this great big cottonwood tree. And the star said, that's where I'm going to live. And it went into the cottonwood tree. And to this day, when you look at the cottonwood tree, it has all these stars in it. And the sound that that little star never heard anywhere else and it wanted to be close to was the sound of people and the children laughing and saying kind words to each other.
When we find performers in Indian country, oftentimes we get pleasantly surprised when we find a chip off the old block. By all accounts, our musical performer today proudly carries the gifts forward from his dad. From the great tribe of Geronimo, the San Carlos Apache in Arizona, I present a proud enrolled member and very talented flamenco guitarist, Mr. Geron Decker.
My name's Geron Decker, and I'm a San Carlos Apache Indian. And I play flamenco guitar for a living. And I've been playing professionally for the last 7 years in Northern Arizona. And one of the highlights would be in Sedona, where I played at the Enchantment Resort and other fine restaurants around the area. I'm gonna play for you a flamenco guitar song. It's a traditional piece called a Soliares. And if you watch, it's got lots of virtuoso finger picking in it. It's pretty extraordinary to watch and hear. Thank you.
I'd like to thank all of my special guests today for sharing their gifts and talents with us. We invite you to join us next time as we present another great showcase of Indian pride. Whenever you get a chance, do something special for a child. Bye-bye for now. Funding for Indian Pride is provided by the Seminole Tribe of Florida, the Forest County Potawatomi Tribe, National City, the Otto Bremer Foundation, and the members of Prairie Public.